Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It was already said, sustainable development, communicating evidence for sustainable development. Whoa, this is really an enormous challenge. And as said already, sustainable development is a complex and contested issue. It's what we also call a wicked problem, which means that it's very difficult to solve, and because many people from many backgrounds with many different kinds of interests, they are involved. And when many people are involved in a problem, then we need to talk. We talk a lot all day. We talk a lot. And especially when there is a problem, let's talk. It sounds like, okay, it's going to be the solution. And at least it's the start of it. We talk so much, people who call themselves managers, research shows they talk like 80% of their time. And when problems really become difficult, then a normal conversation is not sufficient. Eh? Then we need a dialogue. We hear the word everywhere, a dialogue. The Wageningen dialogues are really great. And you know, when it comes to energy transition, to climate change, to sustainable development, we really need a dialogue. And there are some experts in dialogue, and we need experts, because dialogue is not a normal conversation. It's really different from debate or discussion, because in a debate and in a discussion, then we try to win. It's about winning. Eh? Whereas in a dialogue, winning is not the issue. In a dialogue, we are going to explore each other's standpoints, opinions, the underlying assumptions. We try to understand why people think differently and to make a sort of, let's say, let we explore a certain common ground in order to make a next step together. That comes from this big guy, David Bohm, from his book on dialogue. It's an old book from the 80s, but it's still very important when it comes to understanding conversations and how to have a dialogue. I myself, with many colleagues here from Wageningen, I have been studying conversation related to all kinds of life sciences, of which most are complex issues. We have been studying these conversations for years. And we are really looking at the interaction. What is going on in the interaction? How can we understand the course of a conversation? And I can tell you there are not many conversations that deserve to be called a dialogue. It's hard to have a good conversation in the sense that when you have different opinions, when you have conversation between people who really fundamentally think differently, then it's really hard to come together. And in most cases, to be honest, the conversations make it worse. And that's because we all the time we step into the same sort of pitfalls. And these pitfalls, so because we do that all the time, and most of us do it, we call them patterns. And I just want to show you several patterns in order to make you a little bit sensitive of what is going on in conversations and why we think that it could be better, because that's the good news. I think there is a lot of more potential of conversations. When we understand conversations and have better conversations, I think we can also add a little bit to the quality of life. So these patterns, the first pattern is selective perception and framing, and I don't think this needs a lot of explanation. When we are confronted with an event or a phenomenon or a situation, we do not need much evidence, not much facts, to make a story out of it. And that's what people all the time do. We see something and we immediately make an interpretation. And we make a story in the sense that we are seeking for causes and consequences, for a begin, a middle and an end. That's what people do. That's what we always have done. Even the Neanderthals in their caves, they were already making stories in order to make sense of the world, because it's fundamental to make these stories. And as I said, we do not need much evidence. We just select from what we see, what we hear, what we observe, and we make a story out of it, and that's what we call framing. It's a very important concept in communication science and also in practitioners, for practitioners. Framing is really, at this moment, the most popular concept. Framing, so we select, well, I have a definition. To frame is to select some aspects of a perceived reality and make them more salient in communication. And when you make some aspects more salient than others, they go to the background. Eh? And so we, let's say, we emphasize a specific problem definition, causes, solutions. We make all kinds of moral evaluations. And we say all kinds of things about people, about ourselves, identity frames, and about other people. So that's what we all do with framing in order to accomplish specific goals. Because although it's not always consciously, framing is always strategic. We always select, and that's not random what we select. So this is, for instance, by this well-known picture, shows that framing is not random. We all know this picture, I think. It's a polysemic picture, how we call that. When you ask people, then what do you see? Then people say, well, I see a couple making love or whatever. We have all our interpretation about that, our story. And when you ask children until like 6 years old, they will say, hey, I see fishes. I see the dolphins. Yeah. And research also shows that when adults have to discover the fishes, then it takes men a little bit longer than women. So that shows that it's not random. It has to do with our experiences and probably also our expectations, maybe our desires, etc. So that's it. It has also to do how we frame things and issues and phenomena, of course, with culture. Eh? What we see, for instance, when the phenomenon of a dog. This is how we frame a dog in the Netherlands. It's a sort of it's a beloved company. It's even a member of our family. There are people who sleep with their dogs in the bed. Whereas when you go to China, you can find this frame of a dog. It's just like we have pigs. We eat pigs. They eat dogs. So that's a difference. It's also not random because it's a cultural thing. But this goes even further. It's not only a cultural thing. I will just put this one. That's more nice. because we do not have our frames just as an individual. We constantly share and construct frames in interaction. And most of our interactions, of our conversations, we have with like-minded people. Because we like having conversations with like-minded people. We feel comfortable with that. We do not like to be confronted too much with other kinds of people. And this is how, let's say, our network society is sort of organized. It consists of networks, basically of two types of networks that are based on two types of connections. And one connection is called bonding, that's the connections with the like-minded people. And then we have the bridging, that's the connection, the communication with people who think differently, who are part of another kind of network, community, whatsoever. Well, this bonding, that doesn't need much encouragement, but bridging is much more difficult. We don't like that too much. We only do that when it's really needed, in a way. Or when we are completely safe. But in conversations, it's hard to be safe many times. These kind of processes, they are very nicely described by sociologist Robert Putnam in his book, Bowling Alone. Because we talk and communicate most with people who are like us, we start even be more like the others. Eh? So behavior, ideas, etc., they are what you can say, they are contagious. Eh? That's we think that we take our decisions. We are rational and we take our decisions individually, very well thought about it. That's not true at all. We mostly take decisions that our peers, the people who belong to our community, also would take. And this is described in this book, Connected, The Surprising Power of Social Networks. and how they shape our lives. And it's good to realize that we share our frames, that we build our evidence, our facts, etc., in this like-minded networks of people that we are surrounded with. For instance, in this book, it is based on several studies, amongst which how people decide to stop smoking. And we think this is really an individual struggle, etc. But when you see that in a long for a longer time in bigger communities, then you can see that people stop smoking in groups. And that's interesting, because when you realize that, you have different kinds of recommendations when you want to, let's say, to stimulate that. Yeah. Because we construct our frames, our evidence, etc., in groups, in these groups, these facts or this interpretation, they are not so much contested. Eh? And therefore, it's what this very old philosopher already said centuries ago, the truth results from discussions with friends. And I think we should really realize that, because that means that we have different truths, so to speak, or perspectives or insights of whatsoever. Eh? So that's what we also should realize, that that our frames that we take for granted, that we may even mention facts, that they are they can be very different differently perceived by others. Eh? So this all means that. In fact, we should, when we meet people who think differently, we should, in fact, very well listen to them. Eh? And that's something that is not been studied so much in communication science. We mostly study talk. And there is not so much written about it. But since a couple of years, I'm studying that a bit. And I found at least a sort of categorization of different listening strategies that shows how people normally listen, and that also fits with this selective framing in a way. So this is from Scheimer, a German sociologist, and he was studying like 500 conversations in organizations, and he came with four types of listening. And the first type of listening, he calls that downloading. And downloading is listening and then selecting what you already know, and then starting, continuing the conversation on that. So that's, for instance, when people are telling about their holiday, and it was this and that, and then we came in Paris, and then, hey, Paris, I was there last year, you know? And in this way, this is a sort of downloading. You can have a very nice conversation, but it's not very innovative, probably. And it's safe. Eh? It's the conversation between like-minded people, you could say. 80% of our listening, Scharmer says, is downloading. Object-focused listening is really listening to something new. Eh? Just really being curious. Tell me, hey, you'd think differently. What is your perspective? How come? But we are not that curious. The most curious people in the world are children. They really want to know. And we want to know specific things. Most of the time, we want to know things that confirms what we already think. Eh? And then you have empathic listening. That is listening and just postponing your own judgment and your own ideas, and just really be open to the other. It's very difficult. Coaches can do that. They have a long education for that. Scharmer says, those three types of listening, they are all functional, but we should maybe balance them a little bit more. And when you do that, he says, then it comes to, you have these conversations, and I think we all know that as well. They are in a sort of flow. You come out of, when you enter conversation, you really think, wow, I learned something new, and the other person as well, your conversation partner. These are the generative listening conversations. And in these kind of conversations, then, you know, the dialogue starts to take place, you could say. Then, when it comes to how we deal with knowledge and evidence and facts in conversations, I just would, then you can see that what I think that is knowledge and facts, what it's doing in conversations is that it is being used in order to build evidence mostly for getting people to our side. Because this listening, we are most of the time downloading, and when we meet other people, then instead of being curious and asking for their perspective, we try to convince them and to get them to our side. And we use a lot of evidence and facts in order to do that. And then it's interesting, and that's what we studied, is what then happens in the interaction. And I just want to show you a little piece of a conversation that shows what happens with facts and knowledge and trying to convince and use this in a conversation. And it's about the relation also between knowledge and emotions, because that's something when we talk about knowledge in communication, we should also take emotions into account. So I explain the situation. It's in Rotterdam, here in the Netherlands. There were plans of the municipality to place an asylum seeker center there for the refugees from Syria. And the people from this neighborhood, they didn't want that. And they had a sort of conversation with the mayor of Rotterdam and all these people coming to this place.
Oh. Hallo, goedenavond. Ik ben mevrouw Schram. Ik woon hier aan de overkant. Wat ik ook even kwijt wil, ik ben sinds 1 juli werkeloos. Ik word van geen kanten geholpen. Ik moet heel veel geld inleveren van mijn loon. Dat is bijna €300 netto. En waar sta ik dan hier? Want ik word dan van geen kanten geholpen. Ja, je moet solliciteren. Maar al die mensen die hier komen en die overal in Rotterdam wonen, ik ben heus niet boos op ze, maar ze krijgen alles van elkaar. Ze mogen meubelen kopen in tweedehands zaken. Ze krijgen geld van de sociale dienst. Waar blijf ik dan?
The story of this lady in this neighborhood, and you hear the story, and well, she's mentioning all kinds of things that these people, these refugees, would get, and she not, and she has a very personal story, and also quite emotional. And then it's to the mayor, it's Abu Taleb, to react. And this is really, both people are very kind people, I just have to say. It's, for me, it's what is happening in this interaction. Now I show you the reaction of the mayor, and then you can see what happens then. Eh?
Mag ik daar een eerlijk antwoord op geven? Een gezin, man, vrouw, twee kinderen in de bijstand krijgt aan uitkering is dan meer dan €1200 en krijgt alle. Een gezin van man, vrouw en twee kinderen krijgt €1200 en nog iets meer aan bijstandsuitkering. Daarbovenop komen toeslagen voor ziektekosten, voor huur. En ook nog eens als er kinderen zijn, ook nog kindertoeslagen. Een gezin van twee. Niet schreeuwen. Het helpt niet.
Mevrouw, gaat u even rustig zitten.
Het helpt niet zo schreeuwen. Dit zijn, mevrouw, dit zijn de feiten. Een gezin in de bijstand. Man, vrouw, twee kinderen heeft een uitkering van €1250 in de maand. Maar daar moet u echt naar me luisteren. Nou komen er toeslagen bovenop voor huur, voor ziektekosten en voor kinderen. Dat gezin heeft ongeveer netto in de maand €1600 te besteden. Dat zijn, mevrouw, dat zijn de feiten. Het feit dat mensen soms met leefgeld het moeten doen, komt omdat die mensen zichzelf, om wat voor reden dan ook, en ik veroordeel niemand, zichzelf in de schulden hebben gewerkt. Nee, mevrouw, ik veroordeel. Mevrouw, ik veroordeel niemand. Ik zeg ook niet wie de schuld heeft. Ik zeg alleen dat als je van contant geld moet leven per week, dat er omstandigheden zijn die maken dat mensen niet kunnen rondkomen. Maar echt, dat gezin waar ik net sprak, krijgt zo ongeveer netto 1600 euro in de maand te besteden. En dat is ongeveer het salaris waar een politieagent voor werkt. Dus laten we elkaar goed in de ogen kijken.
Ja, yeah, and this is, you know, you may think it's extreme, but these kind of conversations, we all have them, I think. This lady is bringing to the fore, she's trying to convince the mayor with her emotional and very personal story, in which she also has some facts that you could check, whether it's true or not. But what the Abu Talib is doing, he is really using, reacting with facts, not reacting to the story of the lady. And let's say that is not, we really have to take into account that not the intentions in this case of the speaker, of Abu Talib, they decide upon the course of the conversation. It's how people take that, interpret that. And this is when you bring the facts, then you in fact are also blaming the other part of you don't know the facts. You know, if you know the facts, then you would have a different kind of opinion. And that's what, how we most of the time use facts in our stories. And the interesting thing is that it doesn't work. It doesn't convince. Even the, let's say, the background of the facts is sort of mistrusted by the other party. So when we are trying to talk with people who think differently, also when it comes to this very complex issues like sustainable development, this is really not working. So we should really do a different thing. And we should also take into account these emotions, because emotions is also something, we act upon emotions as if we can really separate them from the facts. Whereas emotions, in fact, also show a lot of facts. And there are no facts that we can understand without any emotions. So we really have a problem to deal with emotions that we think also they are a sort of irrational. We consider them as a sign of weaknesses. And we think we can exclude them from the facts. As a result, a lot of our conversations, a lot of our, are quite violent. And that's because not because we intend to be violent, but because other people feel insulted, they feel blamed, etc. And that's what we should really take much more into account, I think, that in a conversation with people, it's not only about content. And most of the time, when we feel uncomfortable because people think differently, in most of the time, the content very easily goes to the background, and it's all about identity. And I think we should really take that into account, that we should respect each other. And that starts with listening with attention and respect. And that's something that sounds very obvious, but that's something that we do not easily, as our research shows. So that means that listening, instead of trying to bring to the fore your story, you can train yourself in asking questions simply. It's also important to recognize different kinds of truths. That's also more safe, because one of the reasons that people don't want to give in conversations is that we are afraid that we should, let's say, leave our own opinion. And that would mean that we are asked also to leave our social network, so to speak. Whereas in most cases, more perspectives are possible. And we can have discussions for days about the 6 and the 9, but when we ask questions, why the hell do you see a 9? From the moment that I discover the other person is seeing a 9, he will also realize why I see the 6. And then you have two perspectives, which is, and then you can see how can we combine them, or what can we do in a creative way with multiple perspectives. The third one is make underlying norms, assumptions and fears explicit. It's a sort of opposite what Abu Talib did. Try to understand what is really going on with this lady, and instead of bringing these facts that of course will only make the distance between the opponents bigger. So underlying norms, assumptions and fears, because the so-called facts, they have all kinds of reasons that they are brought to the fore at a specific moment. Take emotions seriously. They are in terms of communication, they are one of the most important communications means that we have. They really show what people really find important. So try to explore them, I would say. And finally, be aware of identities and relational dynamics in the conversations. And I think when we try to practice a little bit with these guidelines, we might be able to improve our conversations, and I think that would help at least to, that would help to solve these kind of complex problems. And we could really improve the potential of our conversations. And I think we should do that for ourselves to live in a better world, for all the other people, and I would say especially for our children. Thank you.
So is there anyone who would like to ask something or say something about what they heard today?
Hi, I'm Marieke de Vries. I'm an alumni from Wageningen from the Social Studies. I was thinking about the situation that you said that you have like-minded groups and you are part of that group. Well, I came from Wageningen and I now live in a small Frisian country, our city in the north with only 1,000 people. A lot of people who live there have lived their whole lives. A lot of the women, they didn't go to university, they just did like the secondary school. And what I find now, that for me it's a little bit hard to get the connection at the school from my children, because they for me feel that they're all interested in like the small talk, and me with my background I'm more thinking about the SDGs. So could that be that that I am not fitting into that community? And in this situation, I am more fitting in the community, I guess. And because for me, I feel like it's very hard to make that connection. Yeah. And I'm going to stay there probably in that house for the rest of my life. So what could be some of the tips? Because I'm one of those persons that doesn't want to take away my own identity to be kind or have people to like me or something like that.
Well, it's really a nice example, in fact, of this this story that I told here, and I think at least it's worthwhile to invest, I would say, and I think you may have much more in common than it would look like, that you are indeed, you are here, Wageningen, the big issues, and I want to know about it. I watch Tegenlicht and all these kind of things. But these people, they have a mother. They may be a mother or a father, and they want the best for their children. And they also know absolutely more about, they also may watch television, etc. So I would, try to connect, at least to ask them as much as possible about their lives, and then you will find a moment that you say, here is, this is also of interest of me. But you have to give this, let's say, sort of coincidence a chance, I would say, trying a lot. But maybe other people have other ideas about that.
My name is Rolf. I work for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Related to the question on the SDGs, that's something we are struggling with also. And what I find is that, as we sit around here, or as we are working on the ministry, etc., that these are all people who are aware that these are holistic, complex issues. And that I think we should be aware of that, and that people in our villages or my neighbor don't think of it that way. But you still have to make that connection and to be aware of it. So as far as the SDGs, it's just an acronym. And the fact that we are all using that distances us from what other people deal, because they are also working for a better world or for the issues in which the SDGs work for. Thank you.
So you also plead for the connection in that, but breaking it into other pieces, different language. Thank you.
Yes, I was asking, in referring to the clip you showed, In this clip, and also, for instance, in the Paris Climate Agreement, a lot of time the arrangements we make to enter a dialogue are people opposed to each other. So you get these kind of discussions. So in order to be generative listening or empathic, what kind of setup would you need to create this?
Yeah.
What kind of arrangement do you need to make to come to an agreement?
Yeah. Well, in this case, it was the first and the last time that they did it in this way, because these are all angry people coming, and then, you know, it's very hard, of course, to react on that. Although we are in many times confronted with this kind of unexpected situation. That's why I show it. After this, they organized it in a very different way. They made small tables, and they just invited people with a restricted amount number of, like not more than 10, and then they could have really a discussion. So that's much better. And they were also much better prepared for, let's say, dealing with emotions and with, let's say, with people who were, let's say, were complaining about this this refugee center. So they learned from it, yeah. And they made it in smaller groups and much better prepared to make connection.
Right.
And that helped, yeah.
Thank you, Noël. Is that all right for you? I was also having thinking of a question right now. Like, why is it so difficult actually for us to deal with emotions? And why have they become kind of not important or kind of weak or feminine or these connotations of angry people, racial issues that come up? Why is it so difficult for us?
Yeah, I think it's also something that has to do with it already starts when we are very young. We are supposed not to express our emotions. When we are crying, people say, be quiet. When you are angry, people become scared. And even too happy, you don't want to be too happy also, because that could irritate people, especially in the Netherlands, you know, be quiet, do normal. So that's something we are not used to express. And therefore, we become a little bit uncomfortable when other people express emotions. We are simply not trained to do that, so we make it immediately sort of rational, and we even accept it less from already from boys. Don't cry, hope. Whereas the little girls, you say, come here. So I think that has to do with that we feel uncomfortable. We don't know what to do. We don't know what to expect, etc. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Jules from IUCN. Thanks for the presentation. It was really interesting to learn about dialogue, discussion, the different forms of listening. I liked your network graph slide, where you showed about the grouping and bridging. We've been looking at using network analysis to understand sort of change in network dynamics as one of the main consequences of our interventions in complex systems. And I wonder, have you seen good examples of where you can see those maybe different groups bridging and sort of coalescing into bigger groups around certain issues or themes? Has work been done on sort of tracking the metrics of that change in the network dynamic? Thanks.
Yeah. Well, you see a lot of group dynamics. That's happening all the time. The dynamics of let's say. For this example of this refugee center, all these people who were so much against it, they were interviewed. This was 2 years ago. They were interviewed a couple of weeks ago. And then it appeared that they had a completely different opinion now, as in we were then afraid and we were really all the time talking with each other. And now they are also involved in, let's say, voluntary work, etc. So there has a sort of change. I think when you would make a network analysis, you would see sort of, let's say, a different movement. And in very small, I had a nice example of a student of mine of Wageningen last year. It was he was wondering how is it possible that people vote for this ultra-right wing political parties, yeah, the PVV, the Party of the Freedom in the Netherlands, he was wondering. And I said, why don't you go to study that? So that's what he did. Eh? He went to these places where he could expect a lot of these ultra-right-wing voters. And he was talking with all these people, interviewing them, tape recorded them. And after a few weeks, he came to me and he said, I'm quite confused, he said. And I said, what happened? And he said, you know, these are very kind people. And he was really like, we had very nice conversations. And I learned from these people, not that he now became such a PVV voter, but there was much more understanding. And I listened to several of these conversations, and it was really interesting how this sort of changed both sides. Huh? And that had to do because of the setting. It's an interview, so he couldn't say, hey, you stupid PVV voter, you know, he had to be polite, etc. That already had a sort of different kind of conversation. That was also really interesting. So that's very small, that you see things changing. And he, according to this theory of connected, now I'm telling this story, you tell the story, and this kind of ideas, you know, this makes the world move, eh? This sharing of ideas and slightly or suddenly changing the conversation.
Gavin Brittany, you mentioned four listening strategies by Sharma. Often context shapes the strategy, or the strategy can shape the context. In, for example, in semi-structured interviews for qualitative data, when the interviewer may be seen to have more power in the conversation, what kinds of listening strategies would shape a good context for good data?
I think it's a very good question, but I don't think there is one answer to that, because that also depends on what you want to know and how many interviews you will have. You have a survey, then you really have to do it systematically, etc. So it's hard to say, but when you really want to invite people to talk about underlying assumptions and norms and critical thoughts they may have themselves, yeah, then it's questioning, and also making use of silence in a very in a way, yeah, because people don't feel comfortable with silence. So when you also use silence, people start talking again, and sometimes they, you know, so you have several techniques, but it depends on the question, I would say.
Hi, Christian Binnick from CTA, just next door. I think I've been doing a lot of downloading during the session, but I've been processing while the questions were going around. And I wanted to go back to this diagram of the, you know, the bridging and the...
What bonding. Was the thing?
Bonding, yeah. And here we are all people working in the development sector. We are about making change or social change or behavioral change. We all talk of theories of change and so on. So what should we be looking out for? Because we are trying to have a purposeful behavioral change in society. What would be your advice in terms of the analysis to be done in terms of the bonding and the recognizing the bonding and the bridging? And what do we look for in terms of opportunities for bridging? Because I think we are all about trying to create the bridges, but we need to know how to create the strong bridges that will be sustainable. But then we still want to do it in a purposeful way. We don't want to build the wrong bridges.
Yeah.
So while we are being, you know, we're doing the generative listening, we still have to do some filtering to say, okay, this is what I should guide you or nudge you towards.
Yeah.
What would be your general advice for practitioners in the room here?
Yeah. I mean, bonding is a very good thing. We are all together here. We are here in Wageningen 1 and for quality of life. And that's a good thing, because that makes a lot of energy that we can, with which we can go into the world and have bridging when needed. Eh? So bonding is, in fact, a very good thing. But bonding becomes a little bit sort of, you could say, dangerous, or it will gradually go to what we call groupthink. And that means that there is no critical thinking possible anymore. So when there are no critical answers, when the diversity reduces, then it becomes vulnerable. I would say. Or when you feel like, you know, everybody is thinking that way, you know, I feel it may also be that way. And you don't have the courage anymore to post your deviant opinion, then you should do it, because, you know, we always need a sort of advocate of the devil. We need people who think differently. We need all the time to check our underlying norms and our silent assumptions, because that's what we all have. So we should be aware of that, I think, and go as much as possible in other networks. Because, you know, it's also a complaint of the social media, like Facebook. Facebook is even feeding our bubble, because they filter for us, this is what you like, because I see what you liked in the past. So, you know, we are, it's a sort of a very strong pattern that we feed ourselves, and now also via the social media, but in fact that's also ourselves. So be aware of that, I would say. And when you see people, when you meet people who think differently, be curious. Talk to them.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Christiane van Oppem from DRI. I have another question about the bridging, because I guess advocacy and awareness raising, that would fall under bridging. And looking at your clip on Abu Talib, for me the implication is that the use of facts has a kind of limited return. Yeah. But then how would you reconcile that when you advocate to someone who perhaps doesn't have an emotional connection to the SCGs?
Yeah, but that's we then facts and emotions as a sort of instrument for the conversation, and I would say we need both. We need, and because emotion is, when you say feeling instead of emotion, it already sounds differently. Yeah, so I think we should connect by connecting our feelings, and then, you know, you can, of course, facts play a role. There is nothing wrong with facts, but I think the connection is, should be made first. And in my experience, you connect by means of feeling, and then you can share all kinds of things to make people aware. I don't think we should really, let's say, separate both. I would say we should give both ratio and emotions. We should give that space in the conversation to let people feel safe, feel respected. And people feel respected when they are listened to. And that sounds very obvious, but we have difficulties with that.
My name is Anita van Stel. I'm a freelance communications consultant. How do cultural differences have impact on listening strategies? Mm-hmm. Have you studied these as well? Because yeah. I didn't hear you mention them.
Yeah, well, one of my PhD was studying negotiations from Dutch universities and China, university in China. And that was absolutely a very interesting intercultural issue. He was focusing only on the role of silence in these conversations. And that was already such an enormous thing for miscommunication, you can imagine that. So I would say culture is about China and the Netherlands, but culture is also about, let's say, farmers and nature conservationists, because of this bonding and this bridging. One of my students is studying, let's say, the conversations between biotechnologists here from Wageningen and organic farmers. It's extremely interesting, but they live in different worlds, and I'm trained as a cultural anthropologist, and I have always a sort of cultural perspective. That's where, for me, studying communication starts with, because every person has a sort of own culture, I would say, and therefore we should never take for granted that people, that you think that people would think like you think. That's in most cases not the case. So I think it's extremely important, yes, when you study people from different, like China, the Netherlands, but even within the Netherlands, even within the university, you can find different kinds of cultures.
My name is Jorge Chavez Tafur. I work with CTA here in Wageningen. You mentioned a few characteristics of Dutch society, and we could also mention another one, which comes from your example, a very horizontal society where it is possible for a citizen to go and talk with the mayor, and it happens. Now, in most other parts of the world, mm-hmm. that is not so easy. And we are confronted with very hierarchical yes. structures, and the role of power, of course, plays a very important well, has a very important role in, yeah. in dialogue. Don't you think that, well, power makes it an even yes. power, distributions, makes it much more difficult than what perhaps you are presenting here?
You say it's true, maybe in comparison that the Netherlands are a very it's a horizontal society. However, I give training dialogues to different kinds of organizations, amongst which municipalities, Rotterdam, other cities. And then, you know, the people who come to the courses, to the training, they come because they say, I have a problem to communicate with my citizens. But once the training is continuing, then most of the time it appears that not the communication with the citizens is the problem, but the communication with the people who are higher in the hierarchy in the municipality. That's their problem. That's much more difficult. And because they don't have, that's the problem, they don't have space in the conversations with the citizens. So this let's say, having a dialogue with people who have more power, well, that's also something that people should really train. And even then it can help to take into account these kind of principles. Because power is also a dynamic that is continuously negotiated in every interaction, which also gives a sort of, let's say, potential for people who feel less empowered to empower themselves in the interaction. So I think that's something that deserves special attention. Yeah, but also here in the Netherlands, I would say.
We're going to round off for now with the questions. Jan, do you have maybe a final question for Noël? Do you have something you want to say?
Well, I was thinking about the opening of Jacques, and he was speaking about innovation and that needs interaction between disciplines, and maybe that some of the present interdisciplinary fields will be disciplines. So that made me thinking: do researchers also need to be stronger in that bridging attitude or bridging thinking, and how can we foster that? How can we help them there?
Yeah, well, I think so. I think Wageningen, in that sense, is doing a really good job, because we are here. You know, at least we from the social sciences, we always work with the betas. But there is a lot of tension as well in this, and that is because we tend again to consider our own paradigm as the one and only paradigm. You know, this is the way you do research. You have different kinds of questions, you have different kinds of research methods, and we should really capitalize on the differences. And in that sense, again, instead of saying, hey, but my method is better than yours, we should be curious and ask others, hey, what is your question, and explain me how you are going to study that. So I think being curious again, and don't judge about the other. Consider them as complementary.
Thank you very much.